Grace be to you, and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text upon which we base our meditation today is the epistle lesson on this Transfiguration Sunday. I'd like to expand the text and put it into its context by also reading verses 1 through 9. Therefore, since through God's mercy, we have this ministry to tell others about Jesus, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. This is God's word. Dear friends in Christ, as I looked at this text earlier in the week, this portion of God's word, it reminded me of many of you who have asked me questions about trying to tell other people about what we believe. And the reason you've come to me most of the time is because you're perplexed, as this word was used by Paul, as to how to deal with or talk to a son, a daughter, a neighbor, a sister, a brother, even a dad or a mother, and sometimes even a grandparents or grandchildren. You tell me about what you've told them, and you tell me what you've been saying to them in the past, and yet it still doesn't seem to stick. What am I doing wrong, Pastor? And I know I would love to give you the perfect answer. I would love to give you the magic words that you just go to this person you've been trying to witness to, you say these two sentences, and boom. Instant believer, they'll be jumping up and down, rolling side to side, and saying, "I believe it, I believe it, I believe it, let me come to church with you." But I don't have that answer. I don't have those magic words, and Paul understood the people who lived in Corinth were still asking him this also. They wanted something that they could say. And Paul admits, the great missionary that he was, that I wish, at least he always thought, he wished it worked that well, that easy. When Paul, oh, he doesn't tell us, but Luke tells us about some of the things that happened to Paul in his ministry, I'm reminded of the fact that though he was a fantastic missionary, I mean, his dedication, his passion, his love for the Lord, and trying to always put the Lord first, I mean, even when he didn't have enough offerings to support himself, he'd start making tents on the side to support himself so he could keep doing that ministry. But as Luke reminds us, there's times when he got beat up, jailed, kicked out of town, let alone the sort of the natural disasters of shipwrecks and all the other stuff, getting bit by poisonous snakes, although that still worked out because he shook it off, and since he didn't die from it, a whole bunch of people on Malta believed he was somebody special. And his thorn in the flesh that he asked God to take away more than once, how it interfered with his ministry, made it harder to do the job that he had, and God wouldn't take away that problem. And Paul knew that if he didn't have that problem, things would be better for the ministry, not just himself. And yet, God let him still have that thorn in the flesh. And we don't even know what that really was. But Paul simply went on and said, "Okay, I know God's using this for a good purpose." And that became part of his witness also. I empathize with anybody who is frustrated with this. In fact, when somebody tells me it seems to be impossible, I don't argue. I don't argue with somebody. I don't say, "Well, have you tried this and this and this? I have seven different things you could try now that I know what your issue is." Sometimes I agree that it's impossible. I've tried to think of a metaphor, like, what would it be like to try and explain to a blind person what a rainbow looks like? Say you've got somebody who's never seen anything. They've been blind since birth, and you try to explain a rainbow or a sunset. You have no references. You know what's red? What's red? What's green? What's blue? What's orange? What's a cloud? Oh, it's sort of water vapor, and it sort of floats in the sky and has different different shapes. What are shapes to somebody who has never seen? And so I understand when somebody thinks about it that way, that trying to explain Jesus to somebody who's blind to the gospel and seen that way. And I said, I will tell people, it's not that hard. It's not impossible. But I will also still say it's not that easy. I sort of, that if they want to use that metaphor, I'll use the metaphor. Remember those magic eye pictures? They're not a fad anymore, but magic eye pictures, I don't know, 10 years ago or something like that. It was a picture with all these colors, like a kaleidoscope of things. And if you stared at it close, you could see a 3D outline of something inside of that picture. My daughters could do it. I could not. I made my eyes blurry. I squinted. I tried the cross-eyed thing. I tried different things to try and see those pictures. And even last night I pulled up on the computer to see if they still have those things anywhere. And they do have some of those, although the company went bankrupt. They lost the fad completely. And I still couldn't do it. Now I did it once in a while. My daughters would sort of draw on the picture where the dolphin was. And then they draw with a black marker where the palm tree was. Nah. Well, yeah, I could see it then. So we get another picture out, and they take just their finger and sort of show where it was. And sometimes I got it. And it was sort of like a eureka moment. I saw it. Where is it? Oh, it was there. I can't do it again. They could do it. To me, that's more maybe a better metaphor about trying to reach out to other people with the gospel. It's not impossible, but I'll still tell people it's hard. Don't give up. Try different things. I do remind myself, though, of what I'm trying to do when I don't give up. I don't want to go to deception, as Paul said there. I don't want to try and use secret and shameful ways, trick people into like coming to church, or trick people into trying and hold up false promises. And that's what bothers me about some of those evangelical preachers on TV. That if you become a Christian, oh, your life is going to get better, you'll be more successful, you'll even win the Super Bowl. I don't like those teachings because they're a false presentation of the gospel. They're deceptive, they're distorted. God never promised an easy life once we become a Christian, and if you don't understand that, you have not read the Old Testament, and you have not read the book of Acts, and you have not considered what Paul went through in his life. Read the whole Bible sometime and show me some people that were wealthy, healthy, and wise. You'll come up with some. But if you read about their whole life, there's parts of their life you wouldn't want either. But if you understand where these people ended up, just like even with Moses and Elijah in our gospel lesson today, that upon their death, they ended up in heaven. And again, Moses, we can hit all the highlights and think about how great that was to be the leader of God's people, show Pharaoh who's who, you know, and a few other things. But think about Moses when he got that call at 80 years old at the burning bush. He was very eager to do that job, wasn't he? He had 6 good excuses as to why God was picking the wrong person. And God reasonably answered each one of those excuses, but Moses still wasn't buying it, so God finally said, "You're doing it. Get up, get going." Elijah was the great prophet who even tackled the prophets of Baal to show them who's who. And after God burned up that altar and everything on it, and the water that had been poured around the altar, and that should have done it, King Ahab and Queen Jezebel still just wanted a wanted dead poster on Elijah, so he fled for his life and headed down to that same Mount Sinai that Moses had been at, that Jesus was referring to. And he asked God to take him home. He's tired of the job. Didn't want to be a minister or a prophet for a God anymore. Let me just go home. I want to go to heaven. I'm tired of this place. Nobody believes in you anyway. And God had to tell him there were 7,000 people back in Israel still believe. You know what I thought of that number when I was in Sunday school? As a fourth or fifth grader? Wow, that's a lot of people. You know what I think of 7,000 as a number today? When I see how many people go in one football stadium or some other things, there were only 7,000 people. That's kind of sad back in Israel. But God still knew there's 7,000 people that have not bowed down to the prophets of Baal. You've got a job to do. You need to help them. You need to serve them. You need to be there for them. So here's the next three things I've got for you to do. So Elijah got up and went back to the ministry until God called him home. The reality of Christianity is I'm not trying to get people to be like me or to have my life. And that's what you shouldn't be doing either. Here, dear friend, become a Christian, you'll be as happy as I am. Become a Christian and you'll have my life. Well, guess what? Some people don't want your lives, or sometimes they don't think you're very happy. So don't distort it. Don't deceive. What is being a Christian? It's not even like the world sometimes think about getting my life better, which is why sometimes I put the letterboard sign back up there and said, Sinners Anonymous meets here 10:30 Sunday mornings. Hi, my name is Gary, I'm a sinner. Not, hi, my name is Gary and I'm a perfect Christian. It's, hi, my name is Gary and I'm a sinner. We're not trying to end up being better people so God will let us into his heavenly home. We know we get to go to heaven because of what Jesus accomplished on that cross. I need to point people not to me and what I believe. I need to point them to God's word and what Jesus did. Just as the disciples being reminded by seeing that little glowing effect that, oh, it's not the miracles, although that reminds us about how big and powerful he is. But it's what he's been teaching us. That's the most important thing. Now, the disciples didn't always get that. Even after Jesus' death and his resurrection, the disciples still went up to him one day and said, Are you going to put your kingdom together now? Like, now you're going to do your earthly kingdom? And now you're going to get rid of the Romans and make Israel, the land of Judah, independent again and strong? Because that's what they were hoping the Messiah would do. Judas also thought Jesus was going to be the earthly Messiah, and Judas was going to be the earth's treasurer. Why do you think he got so upset at Jesus? Why do you think he betrayed him? Because Judas felt betrayed by Jesus when he finally figured out Jesus was a spiritual Messiah and not an earthly power or an earthly king. And even though he tried to get back at Jesus by betraying him to the enemies, Judas realized the truth when he saw Jesus arrested and gave the money back. He said, I betrayed an innocent man. But what was Judas's big mistake? It wasn't betraying Jesus. It wasn't even misunderstanding who Jesus was and what he came to do. Judas's big mistake, biggest mistake that he made at the end of his life, was thinking Jesus wouldn't forgive him. That's who our Savior is. That's what he came to do. He came to forgive us of our... Can we say that all the time? Forgive us of our sins. He's forgiven who I am. Because it's such a part of my nature. That I can understand in a little bit. In a little way I can understand that, because I got a wife that does that for me. I got a wife who tolerates me. I got a wife who puts up with me. I got a wife that's forgiving me even now as I speak about her. And we'll talk again this afternoon. And I'll try and make a good day on Thursday. But that's how I can understand a little bit about what Jesus has really done for me, by saying, Gary Kraklow, I know your sins. I know your faults. I know your flaws. I still love you, I still died for your sins, and I want you to live in my heavenly home for eternity. No strings attached. Now, if I'm not stupid, I do want to thank him, by the way, I live my life a little bit better to show some appreciation. I do want to gather regularly like I am today and worship with you, worshiping him for what he has done for me. But trying to get somebody else just to come to church, or get somebody else just to think this is what we're doing when we open a hymnal and we praise him and we sing him and we confess our sins and get absolution for those sins. If we haven't helped them understand, first of all, what Jesus has done for them, they've got no motivation. At least not proper motivation. In fact, my motivation is even suspect if I don't remind myself of that. And your motivation is suspect if you don't remind yourself of that. I'm here today to tell Jesus I love him back for how he has loved me. And that's why Paul said, don't get perplexed as you try and share that with others. It's going to take some time. They won't see it right away. Don't feel crushed if it's rejected. Don't get in despair. I was persecuted. You're going to get persecuted. Sometimes you're going to get struck down in your witness. Just get back up and do it again. Am I ever going to tell you that I'm not a Packer fan? And am I never going to battle with my son-in-law who's the Seahawk fan? Or the neighbor across the street who's a Pittsburgh Steeler fan? Or the neighbor back when the Packers were losing to San Francisco and he's got his blanket strung over his back fence to remind me who he's rooting for? I mean, if that's important to us in its own way, then getting to heaven and avoiding hell, wow, I have a reason to keep trying to get through the blindness of somebody I care about and tell them who Jesus is. But first, maybe I got to get through my own scaly eyes that don't see Jesus for who he is, just like the disciples on the Mount Transfiguration. So on this day, I ask for God's help to witness to others. But first, I need to remind myself about how much he loves me, where I'm going for eternity. Because then maybe I'll glow a little bit as I try and witness to others. Amen. Please arise. May the love of God, which he has for you and for me, and which goes beyond our understanding, keep your hearts and your minds focused on Christ Jesus. Amen.